We are now joined by Attorney Chris Bendijo, the spokesperson of the Manila International Airport Authority. Attorney, thank you for joining us. Good afternoon.
Hi, Ms. Rica. Good afternoon.
Hi, Attorney. Let's start first with our concern for the employees that are going to be affected. How would the employee and management transition happen, and what will happen to the current employees and the plans for the new management?
Well, beginning this week, we already started with employment contract signing for those MIA employees who will be transferring to NNIC. Now, of course, definitely there will be some individuals who would want to stay in MIA or in government. The concession agreement provides remedies for them, like, for instance, deployment to other government agencies. Or if there are still available positions in MIA, we will offer the same positions to them. Obviously, the intention here is to minimize, if possible, to ensure that there will be nobody who will be left without a job. So far, as of this week, I think close to 400 have already signified, or at least have signed, employment contracts with NNIC.
How many employees are affected anyway, Attorney? Is this going to be a total employee overhaul?
This will really, when we talk about affected employees, it pertains to those whose positions are really related to the operations and maintenance of the terminals. Mm-hmm. So when we say close to 400 have already transferred, we're pertaining only to those who are organic to MIA. There are thousands still that are to be transferred insofar as the actual operations when you talk about terminal operations. But these are positions which are not organic to MIA.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about taking over the current management. What strategies have been discussed to promote collaborative culture between the two?
Well, the constant coordination has been there ever since. Last night, I believe that we've already convened the crisis management team just to be sure that if there's any contingency that would happen within the next few weeks or months, still NAIA would be there to provide their support. During the turnover ceremony yesterday, actually, the MIA General Manager, Eric Ines, had already signified and re-echoed his 110% support and commitment to this vision of NNIC. So I guess insofar as collaboration and concerted efforts are concerned, it's given. We have had coordination meetings. We've had committees that would address specific tasks and functions in the terminals that have been addressed, and it's comprised actually of both NNIC and MIA. And there's also this mother structure, the project steering group, that would really address any and all major concerns of this concession agreement.
Mm-hmm. From previous reports, we are expecting expansion of passenger terminal buildings, additional aircraft parking bays, increase in vehicular parking slots, food, beverage, and retail options are expected. But aside from those plans, what other innovative technologies or systems can we expect within the next few years?
I think one of the major investments would be this visual docking system for our aircraft. Mm-hmm. Because presently, we've had this experience of passengers unable to disembark because of lightning alerts. Mm-hmm. Presently, our parking for our aircraft is still manually done, meaning to say that there's a ground marshal that instructs the plane to park as to their movement. But if there's a lightning alert, this process has to be stopped just because of safety concerns. With this visual docking system, it will be an automated process. Mm-hmm. And regardless of lightning alerts, passengers would be able to disembark. Mm-hmm. I think that would really address major concerns insofar as inconvenience, queuing, and of course, the inability to disembark. As to other investments, I guess it's really a matter of upgrading our existing, like for instance, our baggage handling system. Admittedly, it's one of the oldest facilities in our terminals and would really need an upgrade. So I think the commitment here is that they would be upgrading this baggage handling system to make sure that there would be no breakdowns, because obviously if this BHS system would break down, this is what causes much inconvenience for our passengers when the baggages rather would be late as compared to the passengers. So with these two, I think these are the most important insofar as passenger experience is concerned.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of baggage handling, because we've had problems with that has become national concern. If you remember the Tanimbala scandal before, what are we expecting to improve on this?
Well, As we've explained before, it's not a simple machine. It's comprised of thousands of parts. And I think this is where the advantage of the private sector would really come in. Because insofar as repairs and maintenance, definitely the solution here is to procure these parts and equipment. Now, insofar as the government is concerned, we really have to strictly abide by RA 9184, the procurement law. And this results to delays, not intended, but just for the purpose of being transparent insofar as the bidding process is concerned. Now that it is being operated by the private sector, they can instantly, and of course they'll have the financial capacity to do it, they'll have instant ability to purchase and procure parts. And definitely, this would be an expeditious way of upgrading and maintaining our terminals.
All right. People are concerned about additional costs that may be charged to passengers. Will it happen anytime soon?
The revised AO1 rate has been approved by the cabinet and published last Sunday, if I'm not mistaken. Now, if we will review this revised AO1 rates, there are schedules as to when some of these rates will be implemented. I think what's pressing for our passengers would be the terminal fee or the passenger service charge. But if we will look at the AO1 rate, the increase will be expected on the anniversary of O&M start date, which means it will just be implemented September of 2025. From today until that date, I think we can already expect some felt changes and improvements in our terminals to make it worthwhile.
All right. On this takeover process, are we expecting any problem that might affect relationship between the new management and the regulatory authority?
Well, we've been shadowing each other for how many months already? I think we've had interactions with different committees addressing different concerns from security to commercial. So far, we have had very amiable relations, and I think this is really determined by that singular vision of RSA. With respect to just simply putting it by improving our terminals. So I guess with that common vision, it makes it easier for us to work with, NNIC. And insofar as the function of being a regulator, I think if it's geared towards improvement of the airport, I don't see any problems to be anticipated anytime soon.
Did NNIC discuss how they would ensure balance between operational efficiency and passenger experience, considering that the transition is already happening?
Well, even before the turnover, we've had several discussions with them insofar as their plans are concerned. And judging from what they have presented so far, we understand their perspective insofar as balancing the commercial aspect and the passenger experience. I think it's very clear that, when we want to have improvements, the status quo cannot remain. And that being said, I think that's where the vision is very relevant because if we can really focus on that vision of improving our airport simply, then I guess all other matters are peripheral as the rates and the expected changes. Again, with the plans that they've presented, we really see the wisdom behind it, the logic behind it. And of course, I think they have professional experts from Incheon also who have guided them insofar as the operations and efficiency of our terminals is concerned.
What initiatives can be immediately implemented to improve passenger satisfaction?
Well, looking at their small ticket items insofar as their investment is concerned, I think the soonest to be felt would be those small ticket items from your new toilets to additional seating capacity. We still have ongoing upgrading and fixing of our air conditioning systems. Again, because of their advantage being the private sector, they can really expedite the repair to ensure fully functional elevators and escalators. To my understanding, they've already ordered and purchased X-ray machines, generator sets. And of course, there's also this commitment of San Miguel to contribute as to the issue on flooding. So I guess these matters, and we're talking just about the small ticket items, these would really be felt soonest insofar as passenger experience is concerned.
Looking forward, future-proofing our airports, what did SMC lay on the table to ensure that we're prepared for future growth?
I think insofar as Moving forward, remember in the KPIs, you're supposed to increase passenger terminal capacity from 30 to above 60, and runway movement of aircraft from 40 to 48 movements per hour. I guess all infrastructure is relevant to this, from, for instance, the creation and erection of the new terminal where Philippine Village is located, the addition of taxiways or exitways that will ensure rapid exit of planes, so, which will be landing. Coordination still for the transfer of turboprops. I guess all of this would really contribute to that passenger experience. We are ready insofar as infrastructure is concerned, that upgrading of the terminal, the inclusion of where that Philippine Village is located, would also have additional parking bays for aircraft. So we see that vision, and actually we're really excited to see this come to fruition. Hopefully we're already in 5 years advance, so that we can really experience these investments already.
And finally, before I let you go, attorney, what will happen to Mia after the transition period?
Mia will still be here as a regulator. Its new function as a regulator will be to determine whether or not the key performance indicators of the concession agreement is being met by NNIC. This determination will also determine if the concession agreement can be extended for another 10 years, because the initial period is just for 15. As regulator, definitely with the leadership of GM Eric Ines, his experience in aviation would really help us determine and measure properly the performance of NNIC.
All right. We're expecting great things on this. With that, I'll let you go. The spokesperson of the Manila International Airport Authority, Attorney Chris Bendijo, thank you, and you have a good weekend ahead of you.